13th year as a pastor, and I still forgot that Good Friday and Holy Saturday are in the same weekend as Easter. In my head, I had like put it a week off, like, oh, you have a week. No, it's like three in a row. So, I'm going to do something a little bit different this year, and for Holy Friday and for Good Friday and Holy Saturday, we're going to do an hour-long service at the Garden. And so it's going to be a contemplative time to prepare the soil for the growth that's going to come. But then we'll also do some liturgy. I think Clyde's going to do some songs for us. He had talked about that at our study on Thursday. So I'll send out a full order, though, ahead of time, because it is different, and so that people know what to expect, what you're getting into if you decide to come, I guess. And then on Sunday, we will have our Easter sunrise service. Yay! And I kind of have some good news, because I thought this year might be the last year that we had the view, but I think we have at least 2 years. Because I met with the developers on Wednesday, and they're going to be working on everything north to us until 2024. So that's good, because that means this will be home as a drunk guy. Yeah. Sure, Stephanie.
Wow, okay.
So anyway.
It's 2024, huh? Yeah.
But we still will be seeing the expansion of Powhatan and the build out of exposition. So, like, the things that we've been talking about that, you know, yeah, no, was that what you were doing? Are still going to happen. And speaking of that, we're in a week into our fundraiser, our GoFundMe spring campaign. And it began on April 1st, it's going to end on Mother's Day. And you can find it anywhere online. I've just been pushing it like crazy. Our goal is $10,000. And it's really to kind of step up our aesthetics here, and that's just really actually becoming more and more important. And so there's this balance, I think, that we're going to be working with of staying true to our values and knowing that, like, we're not going to have the green turf of, like, the development around us, but still being able to, for people to be like, that's beautiful, right? And, like, oh, you can do things that are congruent to the ecosystem that are gorgeous. And so with that $10,000, we're going to replace the white pallets out there with cedar picket fencing. Clyde's been working really hard on getting quotes. And then we're going to do some other signage elements and things like that. So thank you to everybody who's contributed. And feel free to please share it. Make ask of other people. We have to just kind of push it. And I know that doesn't feel comfortable, but yeah, you get used to it. I'm kidding. So thank you so much for everything that you're doing to kind of help keep the momentum of that going. I'm excited about the stuff that's coming down our way. So with that said, I'm going to invite Dana forward. Where'd Dana go? Oh, sorry, right there.
You gotta leave the microphone. Hosanna, praise the prophet Jesus, who rides not a war horse, but a colt of peace. Praise to our teacher who comes our way with the gospel of solidarity.
Hosanna!
Save us from the ways of destruction, living Christ.
Save our spirits from being sunk by war, loss, and evil. Hosanna!
Praise the Holy One who comes in the name of righteous peace.
Praise the Holy One who comes in the name of radical love.
Living Christ,
you see no person as collateral damage, but as holy blood. We yearn to be saved from systems of evil that steal our birthright for flourishing. We weep with us for what we have lost through violence, our own mistakes, and the inevitable grief of life. With palm branches and shouts of praise, we welcome your ways of peace and liberation.
Amen.
Oh, it's So I'm going to, this opening song is one that's actually kind of a contemporary one that's getting some play right now. And I thought I wanted to teach you guys the chorus on it, like right from the get-go, so you guys can sing with me when we hit the choruses. Yeah, so I'm just gonna start going on it. You guys are gonna join me. So let's see. Am I coming through the PA? Okay, so the chorus is easy. It goes like this. Now all my favorite colors. And again. All my favorite colors. My sisters and my brothers. See them like no other. All my favorite colors. Okay, now do it with me. I'm going to do it again. Now all my favorite colors. All my favorite colors. My sisters and my brothers see them like no other. All my favorite colors.
That's the song, so join me when we get that.
I woke up to the morning sky first. Baby blue, just like rehearsed. When I get up off this ground, I shake the leaves back down, round, round, till I'm clean. Then I walked where I'd be shaded by the trees, a meadow green. For about a mile, I'm headed to town, to town, to town, in style.
Here we go with the chorus.
With all my favorite colors. All my favorite colors. My sisters and my brothers see them like no other. All my favorite colors. It's a good day to be, a good day for me, a good day to see my favorite colors. My sisters and my brothers see them like no other. All my favorite colors. Now take me to the other side, where baby blue's bird fly. In gray clouds, or white walls, or blue skies, we won't fly, feel alright. Now we going, ooh, 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 yeah, yeah, we going, ooh, 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 ooh. Well, at least I can say I anticipate a homecoming parade as we renegade in the morning and I. Do the chorus a couple times. With all my favorite colors. Yeah, all my favorite colors. Sisters and my brothers see them like no other. All my favorite colors. Yeah, all my favorite colors. Yeah, all my favorite colors. My sisters and my brothers see them like no other. All my favorite colors.
Bethphage and Bethany at the mountain called Olives, he sent off two of the disciples with instructions. Go to the village across from you. As soon as you enter, you'll find a colt, tethered, one that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says anything, ask, what are you doing? Say, his master needs him. The two left and found it just as he said. As they were untying the colt, its owner said, what are you doing untying the colt? They said, his master needs him. They brought the colt to Jesus. Then, throwing their coats on its back, they helped Jesus get on. As he rode, the people gave him a grand welcome, throwing their coats onto the street. Right at the crest, where Mount Olives begins its descent, the whole crowd of disciples burst into enthusiastic praise over all the mighty works they had witnessed. Blessed is he who comes, the King, in God's name. All's well in heaven, glory in the high places. Some Pharisees from the crowd told them, teacher, get your disciples under control. But he said, if they keep quiet, the stones would do it for them, shouting praise. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks, Greg. So we're going to take 10 minutes to kind of center ourselves. If you'd like to, you're welcome to take some time to wander or meditate, whatever this time needs to do for you. Feel free to take advantage of that. There are discussion questions. For 10 minutes, you're also welcome to get into smaller groups and in your program. The questions for today in small group discussions are, what steps has the land taken to care for the land it inhabits? In what ways do we find ourselves honoring the land as sacred? And in what ways do we find ourselves desecrating the land? So we'll come back together in 10 minutes with song. And you're welcome to break out into groups.
Time, with all years, time the world grows, sad for my dream. What's with all this change? Years go by, but I stay. It always stays here apace. How can I keep this pace? The damage done is not changing. Inside of this circle there are no corners to hide. And every line I follow back inside, gravity pulls me from my center every time. Gravity pulls me from my center every time. Hope, where did I lose my when you're quick to choke faith? Where can a man find faith? The damage done is now taking shape. Inside of this circle there are no corners to hide. And every line I follow inside, and gravity pulls me from my center every time. And gravity pulls me from my center every time. Inside of this circle there are no corners from my center every time.
Confessing that I have missed so much about Palm Sunday. I've missed what relevance it had then and what possibilities it poses for us now. I miss so much from the blindness that comes from reading this through the eyes of the privileged. For starters, I've never really thought about the fact that Jesus was really not supposed to be doing this whole parade thing. Entrance processions were a familiar ceremony in the first century, but for anointed kings and conquering generals that had entered Jerusalem over the years, not for this kind of outlier, low-class nobody. I've also never really comprehended that Jesus wasn't crashing some Macy's Day parade. This was not an innocent mistake of forgetting to get your float paperwork in on time. This was a premeditated uprising. And the story of this premeditated uprising begins, like all good stories begin, with committing a crime.
Yes.
The scripture reads, when he got near Bethage and Bethany at the mount called Olives, he sent off two of the disciples with instructions. And I just love this. This is actually funny if you think about it. Go to the village across from you. As soon as you enter, you'll find a colt tethered, one that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. Then he says, if anyone asks you what you're doing, say, his master needs him. Like, that would just be the perfect solution. Like, nobody would question that. Oh, okay. So the two leave and find it just as he said. And of course, as they are untying the colt, its owner said, what are you doing untying the colt? And they say, his master needs him. This is how the story begins. Jesus and the disciples getting into what John Lewis would refer to as some good trouble and necessary trouble, which is wonderfully accurate description of what this parade was. A communal effort to offer witness to the real and present possibility of liberation from an oppressive system. And admittedly, this is another aspect of the story I have been blinded to by my privilege. The purpose of this parade was not to draw attention to Jesus as Messiah, but to draw attention to a liberative movement that had gained enough momentum to challenge the power structures of that day publicly and effectively. Jesus is so much cleverer and more calculated than the washed-down version of the story has described him to be. There are two things at play when Jesus initiates this parade. First, he is deflating the power of a system by reclaiming a ritual that was set apart only for the elite. Jesus is enacting a political satire by recasting the classless in the part scripted solely for the elite. He is offering a playful demonstration that power in the form of the ability to organize and influence is not limited to bloodline nor to class designation. Second, Jesus is making the power of the movement visible. so that even after his death, the movement would have a chance to live on. This was an uprising that would be difficult to forget, making the power of the movement easily remembered. This is a public demonstration that deflates the authority of the power systems by using the same rituals that practiced holding the system in place as the same modes for tearing the system down. This is remarkable, not simply because it is a genius plan, but because it actually worked. Jesus drew a lot of attention to the possibilities of this movement when there is solidarity in action. And he amplified this message so much so that we are here talking about it in the year 2022. And while we do tend to repeat the mistake of hyper-focusing on Jesus as magical savior who will come and fix all our problems and make our lives comfortable again, there are wild and impactful remnants of the belief that there is a better way, a more life-giving, harmonious way of living. Which leads me to my final revelation. The most threatening, risk-taking invitation Jesus was making when the uprising was organized was to sit at the center of the system and take up space. These people, including perhaps especially Jesus, did not physically belong in that space, period. And that is exactly what Jesus inspires them to do. And in doing so, Jesus brands rebellion for us in its simplest form, as an unapologetic communal practice of holding space for the possibilities of liberation from a system that is rapidly breaking people, ecosystems, and the planet. When the systems are as invasive and violent as our systems are, it doesn't take much to cause trouble. I say this because the land is on the precipice of stirring up a lot of trouble. I realized this after my meeting with the Malcor representative this week. When the point was raised multiple times that we were not doing what we had originally said we would be doing, when they put us on a lot located on what is soon to be a very busy and visible intersection. We were not building a church building. We were not a church. In truth, this wasn't shocking. We have never been definable in the system of power that currently exists. But we continue to take up space. By just being who we are and doing what we do, we take up space. We take up space when we claim that we are a church. When we refuse to plow up the prairie or relocate the wildlife or remove native plants in exchange for green turf. When we defend land. When we value the lives of all species in this place as much as we value our own. We are the radical weirdos dancing in the street a day before the Macy's parade, with the prairie dogs and the meadowlarks and the antelopes cheering us on. We are rebellion without ever having tried to rebel. And just as the people that were marching with Jesus into Jerusalem did not consider themselves to be activists, we did not set out to be land defenders. But that is exactly what we will become. A people who seek to create an ecosystem where all creatures can thrive and where all life is sacred. This work doesn't serve corporate profit or generate wealth under capitalism. In a capitalistic sense, it doesn't create anything at all. And this is how our story, our real story, begins. An interspecies community holding space for the witness that a connection to the earth is the most powerful thing you can have, the most valuable research resource in which we could invest. The truth is we don't want to change anything here because everything here is something we love. And that which you love, you want to see grow. I get why the activist with Jesus ended up going home. And I think it was more complicated than just abandoning Jesus. I think they went home for the same reasons we give up on our dreams and give in to the power systems of our day. The systems of power and violence are designed to make it incredibly difficult to go on, to make you think it's crazy to go on, to believe that there's no point in going on. Pat McCabe describes her decision to go on in the work of resistance when she says, I don't have to know how it's going to happen. I just have to be. I just have to not say no. That's what the Spirit told me. As long as you don't say no, we will see this through. It will happen. So I'm doing all in my power to be able to at least not say no. And working very, very deeply and being able to say yes. The story of Palm Sunday ends with the community becoming discouraged and defeatedly walking home. But that story does not have to be our own. I wonder what would have happened if the resistance had lasted. If the people who came with the dream stayed and kept holding space. If the people decided that all they were ever really supposed to be doing was just not saying no.
Should you choose to accept it, is take one of the stones with a word on it, and these are possible metaphors for the divine from an online list of possible metaphors. Some of them are familiar and like things we say often. Some of them are really not. And I tried to go with ones that resonate with like nature and its processes, even if they're not things we see here, like ocean. But this is to get you thinking. So step one is take one that appeals to you, or one that troubles you that you need to think about a bit or something, but just choose one of those and take it with you. Step two is like the wander we sometimes do here. Feel free to walk around the land thinking about what's on your rock, thinking about what you see, and thinking about, do you have a word coming to you for something you might name as sacred or a metaphor for God that speaks to you? And then step three, there are markers and there are blank rocks. You're invited to write something on one of the blank rocks when you're done. And those you're welcome to take with you. There's not a lot of space, so it might need to be like one word and pretty short. But that's the full invitation. Take a rock with a word, wander and think about your own metaphors, your own words, and if you choose, write that word on a blank rock.
So yeah, no, this is. I was planning the song and working with Apple Spanky, and I was telling him like, this is my. I wrote this song years ago, but this place is like the place where I just want to sing this song. We don't have a view because it's windy today, but like sitting here looking at the mountains while I play this song, it's just like this is where the song's going to be. So.
Radio is off, it's just the whistling wind and wheels on the road. I can't see far east, but westward calls me home. Yes, I'm fond of the foothills. Yes, I'm fond of. Look at that sky. Come take your rest, but don't take too long. You know the sunset here is someone else's dawn. And Lord knows there is so much work to do here. Yeah, there is so much work. Westward bound when I want to change my mind. I rise up into thinning air and an evening scent of pine. Bright light, big view, wide eyes, big pictures clean to me. This mountainside I ride on was once dinosaurs in the bottom of the sea. Rocky Mountain high. Sings like a sweet collective dream of the land. Now tell me, do you know your measure as a man? John Long is country heart to heaven. Yeah, he flung his country heart to heaven. Radio is off. It's just the whistling wind that wheels on the road. When I can't see far east, but westward calls me home. Yes, I'm fond of the foothills. Yes, I'm fond of the foothills.
Thank you.
to Eli and Eric and Bev, everyone who got here early and set up, and everyone who's going to help roll the walls up in the wind after this. And Rick, do you want to say something about Friday? Or are you good?
Yeah, well, we're thinking about putting up the next canopy next Friday after the service that Stephanie has from 10 to 11. So at 11 o'clock, if you're willing to stay, I need about a total of about 6 people, including myself, so 5 more volunteers to help.
Yeah, so we're going to have the 4th canopy is going to be set up by the garden, so that our garden volunteers and your mission groups will have some shade and places to eat.
It should take about an hour and a half, 2 hours.
Maybe. It's a lot of fun.
We've got it down pretty well. We know how to do that.
We're
going to raise the roof.
Pray for low wind.
And if the weather goes really south, we'll find another day. I don't want to be out here making it miserable on anybody. So.
Yeah. We can go paragliding.
A reminder to check out the GoFundMe campaign, to share it, to make asks. We're getting there. We're almost at 3,000, so that's it's only going to be. And then as you go forth, I just invite you that walking through Holy Week and the darkness that brings, be reminded that you don't walk alone, and that whether people get it or don't get it, it doesn't mean that it's not right to keep going up. May you go in peace, to work for peace.